بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أما بعد، فحياكم الله أيها الإخوة الكرام، وأرحب بكم في هذه المقطع الصوتي والجلسة الصوتية التي ننشد منها أولا التعاون على البر والتقوى والتناصح والتذكير. قال تعالى: بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر، إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. ومن المناسب في هذه الأيام أن نتحدث عن هذا الأمر العظيم الذي جاء وحدث ونزل بالناس، وهو انتشار هذا الفيروس كورونا الذي فتك بكثير من الأنفس والأرواح، وأصاب كثيرا من الناس بالمرض، وأصاب أكثر أهل الأرض بالهلع إلا أهل الإيمان والتوحيد، فهم متوكلون على الله مع أخذهم بالأسباب التي فيها سلامة النفوس وسلامة الأبدان وسلامة الأرواح. ويجدر التنبيه على أنه من أعظم مقاصد الشريعة الإسلامية حفظ النفوس وصيانتها، ولهذا من الأشياء التي جاءت الشريعة بحفظها وتعتبر من الضرورات النفس والدين قبل النفس، الدين والنفس والعقل والعرض والمال. ومن حفظ النفوس صيانتها عن أسباب البلاء، والبعد عن التعرض للأخطار وأسباب الشر وأسباب الهلاك. وهذا دلت عليه الشريعة الإسلامية في نصوص كثيرة، والله عز وجل بيّن في مواضع من كتابه هذا المعنى. قال تعالى: ولا تقتلوا أنفسكم إن الله كان بكم رحيما. وقال تعالى: ولا تلقوا بأيديكم إلى التهلكة. وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: لا ضرر ولا ضرار. وأنكر النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم على أحد الصحابة الذي أفتى صحابيا آخر أصابته جنابة وفيه جراحة في رأسه، فأفتاه بأن يغتسل ولا رخصة له، فلما اغتسل أصاب الماء في جراحة رأسه، فماذا حدث؟ حدث أن مات بسبب هذا الفتوى. فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: قتلوه قتلهم الله. ألا سألوا إذ لم يعلموا؟ فإن شفاء العين السؤال. وأيضا مما يعني يتعلق بهذا الأمر أن الشريعة الإسلامية جاءت بالأمر بارتكاب المفسدة الصغرى لدفع المفسدة الكبرى، إذا اجتمعت المفسدتان ولا مناص من الوقوع في إحداهما، فإن الشريعة ترخص بل تأمر بارتكاب المفسدة الدنيا لدفع المفسدة الكبرى. فلو قدر أن الإنسان ابتلي فليس له إلا أن يفعل خيارين، الخيار الأول فيه مفسدة والخيار الثاني فيه مفسدة، فننظر أيهما أخف فيرتكبه وأيهما أشد فيجتنبه. هكذا جاءت الشريعة. ومن ذلك قول الله عز وجل: ولا تسبوا الذين يدعون من دون الله فيسبوا الله عدوا بغير علم. فنهى الله عز وجل عن سب من يدعى من دون الله من الأصنام والآلهة الباطلة، مع أنها مستحقة للسب والتحقير وبيان أنها لا تنفع ولا تضر، فنهى الله عن سبها. لماذا؟ حتى لا يسب الله عدوا بغير علم. والنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال في خطبة الجمعة: من قال لأخيه والإمام يخطب صهن فقد لغى، ومن لغى فلا جمعة له. وصهن يعني أسكت. فإذا كان شخص يتكلم وقت خطبة الجمعة هذا لا يجوز، وهذا منكر، فإنكار هذا المنكر مطلوب. ومع ذلك قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: من قال صح فقد لغى، فنهى عن إنكار المنكر. لماذا؟ لأنه يترتب عليه مفسدة أخرى وهي أعظم، وهي التشويش على الخطيب والمصلين حتى لا يستمعوا للخطبة. ومن هذا نعرف أن هذه القاعدة قاعدة مشهورة عند العلماء يقررونها في القواعد الفقهية، وهي ارتكاب أدنى المفسدتين لدفع أعلاهما. ولا شك أن هلاك النفوس بالمرض والعدوى التي تنتشر أمر يجب دفعه، ولا يجوز أن نعرض النفوس للهلاك. وكيف ندفعه؟ ندفعه بما شرع الله عز وجل من الأسباب الشرعية والأسباب الحسية. وأما ترك ذلك وترك فعل الأسباب التي شرعها الله وأباحها فهذا تفريط وتهاون. فإذا ثبت طبيا عند المختصين وبالتجربة انتشار العدوى بسبب التجمعات وبسبب تلاقي الناس، فإن هذا وإن وقع بقدر الله فدفعه والسلامة منه أمر مشروع بل متعين. وسأكمل في المقطع الثاني ما يتعلق بهذا المعنى.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. The Sheikh حفظه الله, he began with praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and sending peace and blessings upon his noble prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then he says that, you know, this is of the blessings, is that we come together in these gatherings that are sound-based gatherings, meaning recordings, where we come together to have reminders and command with the good and forbid the evil and give encouragement towards the practicing of what is pleasing to Allah, then this is a good thing. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned this reality in Surah Al-Asr, where Allah ta'ala says, "Wal asr, and by time, innal insan, verily mankind, lafi khusr, is in utter ruin and loss, illal ladheen amanu, except for those who believe, wa amilu s-salihat, and do righteous deeds, wa tawasaw bil-haq, and they mutually advise each other with the truth, wa tawasaw bil-sabr, and they mutually advise one another with patience upon that practice and of that truth." He says that this is from amongst what this gatherings is about, trying to practice and bring to fruition verses like this. And we're going to use this gathering to talk about this great spread of this disease or this virus that has caused hala' al-kufar. It has caused everyone, the disbelievers and everyone, to be in disarray and in great fear and disturbance, except for the believer. Except for the believer. He is not like that because he understands how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala deals and how he decrees. And so for this reason, the believer, everyone is like this except for the believer. He says, for this reason, we're going to talk about this subject matter related to this. And the first thing we will start is the objectives of the legislation of Islam. One of the objectives of the legislation of Islam is the preservation of lives, is hifzun nafs or nufus, the preservation of lives. And the deen of Islam, is objective is to protect five aspects, not just the preservation of lives, but the firstly, the preservation of the religion, the preservation of people's lives, the preservation of the intellect of mankind and their sanity, and the preservation of people's wealth. And the Shaykh, he says this is indicated in some verses of the Quran. Allah Ta'ala says, "Do not kill your own selves." And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Do not destroy yourselves by throwing yourselves in destruction by your own hand." He says, this here is also a reality of the preservation of the soul, that of lives, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his deen has come to preserve life. As was illustrated in the ayah, the two ayahs that we just quoted, likewise in the hadith of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and has come in Sahih Bukhari, the hadith of the man who had an open wound on his head, and he went to seek a legal verdict on how is it permissible, because he was in a state of janaba, of sexual defilement or a wet dream, and he wanted to make ghusl. He was asking, do I have to make ghusl, or what am I supposed to do? And so he asked the question to a group of believers from amongst the companions who were there. And they gave him a verdict, was saying, yes, you have to make the ghusl. And so the man went and took the ghusl. And when he took this ghusl, or the shower, The water entered his wound and he died. And when it reached the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, قَتَلَهُ قَتَلَهُمْ قَتَلُوهُ قَتَلَهُمْ اللَّهُ. He said that they killed him, meaning the people who gave him that wrong verdict. They killed him. May Allah fight them. May Allah fight them. And so here the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said this, and he said that shifa' al-'eed, that the cure for ignorance is a question. The cure for ignorance is a question. Meaning all they had to do was come and question me or question the Messenger of Allah, and he would have given them the proper verdict on what to do. Which in this case, he would have been ordered to make tayammum and to stay away from the water. He says, so for this reason, you see Islam has come, and these are the two, three evidence that the Shaykh presented in the proof for Islam came. Hifdun nufus, with the preservation of lives, to preserve life. And then the Shaykh Hafidhullah said, we want to talk about a principle that is an oppressive principle from the religion of Islam. And that principle is that if two corruptions meet one another and you're forced to make a choice between them, you take the lesser of the two bad things. If you're faced and forced upon two corrupted bad things, that you take the lesser of the two bad things. And this is a principle in the religion of Islam that we must adhere to and follow. It's from the well-known universal maxims of Islam that we hold firm to these principles because it's of the things that preserve lives. And Islam has come with it to for the preservation of human life. And he gave evidence from the Quran in this regard, that Islam has come, that when two things are facing one another, you only have a choice between them, that you choose the lesser of the two evils. And that is the ayah where Allah Ta'ala says, do not insult the gods of those who, or do not insult the worship or the gods of that which those who worship less than Allah. Well, they will in turn insult Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has established that insulting, that generally in the legislation of Islam, we supposed to refute and expose the false deities and that which is worshipped other than Allah. But here, this will lead to a greater harm, if it's going to lead to a greater harm of them in turn insulting Allah without having knowledge, then we are not supposed to insult and their false deities in that fashion. Because to remove the greater harm of them insulting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we got two harms, either the harm of them insulting or them bringing about the talking of their false deities, or them worshipping their false deities, that either clarify without insulting it, because if insulting it will lead to the greater harm of them insulting Allah, then that's a worse harm. So we take the lesser of the two harms. And he says also, we find this illustrated in the hadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where he mentioned that the prohibition of speaking and having discussion during the time of the khutbah of Jumu'ah, when the khatib or the imam is giving his sermon, that is impermissible to speak. To such an extent, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that if a person speaks and someone says, be quiet, then that person has lagha. He has wasted his Jumu'ah. He has wasted his Jumu'ah. Here, this hadith, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is commanding to leave off doing something that would be deemed as good to do. To stop somebody from speaking during the khutbah. But if a person is speaking, you say, be quiet, then doing that act in of itself will make your khutbah or your reward be wasted in your coming and performing the Jumu'ah. So the Prophet prohibited this act. He prohibited this act because this shows that removing the greater harm is more important than the lesser harm. The greater harm is you speaking, in this case of this hadith, than the lesser harm of the one who speaking and you not saying nothing to him. So here we leave off saying something to him, and you saying something to him. Then you leave off saying something to that person, then this is you causing a greater harm for yourself. So no, you don't create two harms. You leave the greater harm by keeping shut, your mouth shut. Why? This shows that Islam has come with these principles to preserve human lives, to preserve the rights of others. And that the Shaykh, Hafidhullah, he went on to say, these are the things that the legislation has come to protect the destroying of lives. To protect the destroying of lives. And the Shaykh, Hafidhullah, he went on to mention that this is when you see that the doctors are saying that this disease can cause, it can easily spread. It's a rapid spreading disease. And it's been confirmed by the specialist in medicine or the specialist in this arena that it is incumbent then in this case to leave, to stop this greater harm, even though we got to leave, even if we have to leave off the good of praying in the jama'ah, in the congregation, and performing the jumu'ah, the coming for jumu'ah prayer. That if doing that will lead to the greater harm of this disease spreading, then it's incumbent to leave off this good to repel, shoot off that, or remove that greater harm. And he said, these are the things are from the legislation of Islam that has come to protect. And he said, we will clarify more in the second part of this speech. Naam, tafadhal.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. تكملة للحديث السابق عن هذا الموضوع، فإن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ثبت عنه في أحاديث كثيرة ما يتعلق بالعدوى، وثبت عنه صلى الله عليه وسلم أنه قال لا عدوى ولا طيارة ولا هامة ولا صفر. وجاء في صحيح البخاري ومسلم عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال لا عدوى ولا صفر ولا هامة. فقال أعرابي يا رسول الله فما بال إبلي تكون في الرمل كأنها الظباء، يعني سليمة وجيدة وأشكالها جميلة ونشاطها قوي. قال كأنها الظباء، فيأتي البعير الأجرم فيدخل بينها فيجربها. لعلي أشرح لكم، يعني الإبل هي جمع بعير، مفردها البعير، لا مفرد لها من يعني لفظها، لكن البعير الواحد جمعه أبعرة وبعران وبعارين، وهذه تسمى الإبل. قال كأنها الظباء، جمع ظبي يعني مثل الغزال من النشاط. فيأتي البعير الأجرب، يعني المصاب بالجرب، وجرب مرض شديد يسقط الجلد ويوهن اللحم ويفسد الطعم ويفسد البعير، فيدخل بينها فيجربها. فقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فمن أعدى الأول. هذا النص النبوي يعني عظيم جدا، ويبين لنا الرد على جهتين وطائفتين. فإن الطائفة الأولى وهم الجاهليون قبل الإسلام، ولا زال بعض الفلاسفة والعقلانيون يقولون هذا، يزعمون أن المرض والعاهة تعدي بطبعها لا بفعل الله وقدره. وهذا رد عليهم بأن البعير الأول اللي أول واحد أصابه المرض ما جاءه من عدوى، لأنه هو الأول، فإن الله عز وجل هو الذي قدر عليه وأصابه بهذا. فإذا آمنت بهذا وأقرت بأن البعير الأول هكذا، إذا حتى البعير الثاني والثالث والرابع كله بقدر الله، وإن كان بسبب العدوى. وليس المعنى أن العدوى غير موجودة وأنها باطلة لا أساس لها، لكن العدوى التي أبطلها الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم هي ما يعتقده أهل الجاهلية أنها تنتقل بنفسها وبطبعها دون إذن الله وقدره وخلقه سبحانه وتعالى. ولهذا لما قال الأعرابي يأتي البعير الأجرب فيدخل بينها فيجربها، لم ينكر عليه النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم هذا الكلام، ولم يقل هذا غير صحيح، لكن أبطل عقيدة الجاهلية. من هنا ومن غير ذلك من الأحاديث نأخذ أنه يجب على المسلمين الأخذ بالأسباب مع التوكل على الله عز وجل، ومن هذه الأسباب منع التجمعات. وبناء على هذا وعلى الأخذ بالأسباب صدرت فتوى هيئة كبار العلماء في المملكة العربية السعودية، وبعد المشورة مع أهل الاختصاص والمعرفة من الأطباء والمختصين والعارفين بأحوال الدول والعارفين بالأوبئة، فلما سمعوا بما حدث في كثير من البلدان التي تهاونت في هذا الأمر أخذوا بالأسباب. ففتوى هيئة كبار العلماء في المملكة العربية السعودية مبنية على الدليل وعلى التعليل، ومقصود فيها حفظ النفوس. فيجب على المسلم أن يقدر كلام أهل العلم وأن يستفيد منهم وأن لا يأخذ بأقوال أنصاف العلماء أو الذين لا علم عندهم. والوقاية كما يقال خير من العلاج، والدفع أسهل من الرفع. فليتق الله كل مسلم وليلزم جماعة المسلمين وإمامهم في جميع الشؤون، في جميع الشؤون وفي المصالح وفي جميع الأحوال، فإن الجماعة رحمة والفرقة عذاب، وسيجعل الله بعد عسر يسرا. وأنتم في أمريكا عليكم أن تبتعدوا عن التجمعات حفظا لسلامتكم. وقد سئل الشيخ صالح الفوزان عن بعض المسلمين في بعض البلدان غير الإسلامية أنهم يستفتون هل يصلون في المسجد، فقال النبي فقال الشيخ صالح الفوزان لا، يصلون في بيوتهم، لأن هذا من مصلحتهم، لأن هذا من مصلحتهم في هذا الوقت حتى يرتفع الوباء بإذن الله عز وجل، وسيجعل الله بعد عسر يسرا. ونسأل الله عز وجل أن يعافينا وجميع المسلمين، وأن يوفق ولاة أمرنا وعلماءنا والقائمين على الشؤون الصحية لكل خير. وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين، وجزاكم الله خيرا، والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
السلام ورحمة الله، جزاكم الله خير يا شيخ. The Sheikh حفظه الله, he said we're going to complete our what we left off with the previous hadith or what we mentioned. And that in relation with bringing more narrations for clarifying the importance of avoiding gatherings, especially the Jumu'ah, the Jumu'ah and the Jama'ah, the congregational prayer and the Friday Jumu'ah service. He says there's a hadith that's narrated by Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah ta'ala, that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said there is no contagious diseases. And so a Bedouin Arab, he brought up to the Messenger of Allah, then if that's the case, then how come you will have a camel that is healthy, nothing wrong with it, and then it comes in the presence of another camel that it has the disease of Judham with it, which is a disease that tear apart the limbs of the body, destroys them, eats at them until they rips it apart. If you see it comes around another camel that have that disease, suddenly that animal that was healthy, it catches that disease. So what do you say about this if you're saying that there is no contagious disease, O Messenger of Allah? So the Messenger of Allah asked the question, who is the one who gave the disease to the first one? Who was the one who gave the contagious disease to the first one, meaning the first camel? It's a question. Meaning, Allah Ta'ala caused the first one to get sick, and he decreed for the other one to get sick. He says, this is the decreeing of Allah. None of this occurs. The Prophet meant here in this hadith that there is no contagious disease except but with the leave and permission of Allah. And he says here in this hadith, it shows this reality, that this is from the decree of Allah. And this is a pump incumbent that we have faith and believe in this reality as believers of in him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. For there is no contagious disease except with the leave of Allah. And that's why the Messenger of Allah said to the man to answer his question, who was the one who gave the disease to the first animal, to the first camel, meaning Allah. So likewise, he is the one who caused the second one to get that disease. He said you have in the times of Jahiliyyah, in the previous times, that people had to believe that a sickness in and of it by itself, it by its nature, can only it is what causes something else to catch that disease. People believed that and didn't believe that it was through the leave of Allah and the decreeing of Allah. So this hadith is not saying to us that there is no diseases, contagious diseases in existence. No, the Prophet is not denying that reality. But what this hadith is establishing, that it is that they exist, but it exists by the decree of Allah, by the leave of Allah. And that contagious disease will not spread except by the decree of Allah, not because it is a contagious disease in and of itself. And by its nature, that's what it's going to do. No, this is not the belief of the Muslim. So this hadith really shows us, while at the same time, we don't reject the existence of this contagious disease. But it's showing us wujub wa akhdil bil asbab. the obligation of taking the means of protection that is around us from these contagious diseases, while realizing I can only get this disease by the permission of Allah. Your reliance is upon Allah. So it is obligatory upon the believer that they take the means. And we don't reject the reality that these contagious diseases exist. No, we accept this reality. And we work by the means that has been put down to protect ourselves. This is the reason why there has occurred recent a fatwa from Lejna to Da'im, the ongoing committee of major scholars, that the prohibition of praying in jama'ah, congregational prayer, and having the jumu'ah, the Friday sermon services. All of this is something that has been established by them. Likewise, Sheikh Saleh Al-Fawzan was asked this question about closing the masajid and not praying in the jama'ah and not having the congregational prayer on Friday and staying away from them and avoiding them. To Sheikh Saleh, like here in America, Sheikh Saleh Fawzan said that they should respond to this and stay away, for this is for their maslaha, for their benefit, for protecting themselves. This is taking the means that Allah has brought about, that we must take to protect ourselves when there's a spread of a disease in this fashion. So inshallah ta'ala, this is all a part of al-wiqaya min al-ilaj, that prevention is from the cure. Prevention is better than the cure. In other words, preventing yourself from getting something, when using the means to prevent yourself from getting something, is better than becoming sick and now having to take the cure or the treatment for getting rid of that sickness. The best treatment is to protect yourself from that sickness coming to you or afflicting you by seizing the means that's been established by the, in this case we call the CDC and the doctors, and what we must protect ourselves and do our hajru sihi, our quarantining and avoiding one another and doing all of these things. And then the Shaykh Hafidhullah, after that, he began to make dua, closing dua and supplication and praising Allah and sending peace and blessings upon his messenger and making dua for the Muslims here and for Al-Basira and the situation that we have. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Assalamu alaikum.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Wa salatu wa salam ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Amma ba'd, fatakmila lima sabaqa dhikruh min al-akhd bil-asbab, fa'inna hadha al-liqa yahsun fih an nadhakira ikhwanana fi يعني مواضيع تناسب ما نزل بالمسلمين اليوم من هذه النوازل والوباء، ومن الأمور المهمة جدا في هذه الفتن أن الإنسان يلزم جماعة المسلمين وإمامهم، ويلزم منهج أهل السنة والجماعة ومنهج السلف الصالح، ويسير على طريقة كبار العلماء، ولا يستعجل ولا يتصدر ولا يبحث عن أهل الفتن، فإن هذه الأمور تحدث بلبلة في قلوب الناس وتحدث أثرا في الناس. فعادة ما تحدث الفتن بسبب يعني مثل هذه النوازل، فتتحرك القلوب وتضطرب النفوس، وهناك من يبحث عن الزلات، وهناك من يبحث عن الغلطات، وهناك من يبحث عن التصيد، وهناك من يتبع الهوى، وهناك من يبتدع في الدين، وهناك من يعرض عن الدين، وهناك من يظن بالله ظن السوء. فأوصي نفسي وإخواني بالسكوت ولزوم البيوت، ومن صمت نجا كما ورد في الحديث. وأيضا جاء عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أنه قال: أمسك عليك لسانك وليسعك بيتك، وأبكي على خطيئتك.
فأيها الإخوة حذاري حذاري من الاستعجال في التصدر والفتوى والكلام في الأمور العامة التي تعترض على المسلمين وتعرض للمسلمين، فردوا الأمر إلى أهله وكونوا كما أمر الله عز وجل بلزوم الجماعة وترك التفرق في الدين. فقال تعالى: ولا تكونوا من المشركين من الذين فرقوا دينهم وكانوا شيعا كل حزب بما لديهم فرحون. وقال تعالى: وإذا جاءهم أمر من الأمن أو الخوف أذاعوا به ولو ردوه إلى الرسول وإلى أولي الأمر منهم لعلمه الذين يستنبطونه منهم ولولا فضل الله عليكم ورحمته لاتبعتم الشيطان إلا قليلا. فهذه الآية الكريمة عظيمة جدا وفيها الأمر بالرد إلى الرسول وإلى أولي الأمر منهم، وهذا يبين أن الرد إلى الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم هو الرد إلى سنته والتمسك بسنته صلى الله عليه وسلم، والرد إلى أولي الأمر هو بالرد إلى أهل العلم والرد إلى ولاة أمور المسلمين. وقول تعالى: لعلمه الذين يستنبطونه منهم، أي يستخرجونه ويستعلمونه من معادنه. يقال: استنبط الرجل العين إذا حفرها واستخرجها من قعورها. فهناك أمور تحتاج إلى استنباط وتحتاج إلى تدبر وتفكر وسؤال أهل الخبرة، فلا يصلح أن الإنسان من هواه ومن ميوله ومن عاطفته يتكلم بما شاء ويفتي في كل شيء ويتدخل في كل شيء، فلا بد أن يأخذ بهذا التوجيه الرباني وهو الرد إلى الرسول وإلى أولي الأمر من المسلمين. يقول الشيخ عبد الرحمن السعدي: هذا تأديب من الله لعباده عن فعل هذا غير اللائق، وهو أداء به الإذاعة والإشاعة للأشياء بدون علم. قال: وأنه ينبغي لهم إذا جاءهم أمر من الأمور المهمة والمصالح العامة ما يتعلق بالأمن وسرور المؤمنين أو بالخوف الذي فيه مصيبة عليهم أن يتثبتوا ولا يستعجلوا بإشاعة ذلك الخبر، بل يردونه إلى الرسول وإلى أولي الأمر منهم، أي أهل الرأي والعلم والنصح والعقل والرزانة الذين يعرفون الأمور ويعرفون المصالح وضدها، فيرأوا في إذاعته مصلحة ونشاط للمؤمنين وسرورا لهم وتحرزا من أدائهم فعلوا ذلك، وإن رأوا أنه ليس فيه مصلحة أو فيه مصلحة ولكن مضرته تزيد على مصلحته لم يذيعوا. ولهذا قال: لعلمه الذين يستنبطونه منهم، أي يستخرجونه. فلا بد أن الإنسان يجعل الأمور إلى أهلها، إلى أهلها، وإذا صارت مصيبة أو مشكلة يلجأ إلى أهل الاختصاص ولا يتقدم بين أيديهم، هذا أقرب إلى الصواب وأحرى للسلامة من الخطأ. وهذا فيه النهي عن العجلة والتسرع والأمر بالتأمل في الكلام قبل إذاعته. فبعض الناس الآن يستخدم الواتساب ويستخدم وسائل التواصل وينشر ما شاء من المقاطع ومن الكلمات ومن الأقوال، ولا يدري أن بعض هؤلاء الذين نشر كلامهم قد يضل بسببهم خلق كثير فيكون هو متسببا في ذلك، نسأل الله العافية والسلامة. نكمل في المقطع الذي بعده.
The Sheikh Hafidhullah, he said we're going to complete where we left off at, talking about al-akhdu bil-asbab, seizing the means around us to protect ourselves in nawazil, in these catastrophes or these afflictions that affects everyone. And the Sheikh Hafidhullah, he says, it is important that we cling firmly to the body of the Muslims and that we cling firm to the methodology of the major scholars of Islam and follow firm what they are upon during these trials and during these tribulations and during these types of afflictions, and not to get caught up into bilbilat an-nas, the foolishness and the disarray and the confusion that's caused by the people. Because we know that these types of affairs, it causes the hearts to be, to move the hearts and affect them tremendously. And you causes people to follow the whims and desires and follow wrong, the people who are upon wrongness, who want to speak about these affairs, and they're not of the people who affairs should be referred back to. And that this is important for us to understand, to cling firm to the body of the Muslims and cling firm to the methodology of the major scholars and whatever they are upon, as the Sheikh has done in mentioning their fatwa and what they have said. It is in this time is to avoid holding and listening to the foolishness of the foolish ones when they speak, and to stay away from these things, and to stay firm to clinging to the house. As the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam has clarified for us when he says, stay in your homes and cling, hold firm, seize your tongue, meaning refrain your tongue. Seize your tongue and stay in your homes and cry over your sins. For this is the time to adhere to that reality. When we look at the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to avoid being like the disbelievers and the ways that they are upon, as Allah ta'ala says, وَلَا تَكُونُوا مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ, and do not be from the polytheists, those who are pleased, who have in factions and groups and break off into factions and groups, and every group is pleased with what is with them. No, we do not become like this and separate. Or the statement of Allah Ta'ala when he says in the Quran, إِذَا جَاءَهُمْ أَمْرٌ مِنَ الْأَمْنِ أَوَ الْخَوْفِ أَذَاعُوا بِهِ, that when it comes to them a public affair of fear or safety, the first thing they do is spread it. وَلَوْ رَدُّوهُ إِلَى الرَّسُولِ, if only they returned the affair back to the messenger. وَإِلَى أُولِي الْأَمْرِ مِنْهُمْ, and those in authority from amongst them. لَعَلِمَهُ الَّذِينَ يَسْتَنْبِطُونَهُ مِنْهُمْ, then those who they would have truly know the best thing to abstract from in that affair, منهم, from them. وَلَوْلَا فَضْلُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ وَرَحْمَتُهُ, if it wasn't for the bounty of Allah upon you and His mercy, لَتَّبَعْتُمُ الشَّيْطَانَ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا, verily, you would have followed the Satan or Shaytan except a few. He says this here is a tremendous ayah, a tremendous verse, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is commanding us that when it comes to us a public affair of fear and safety, is not to spread it, which we see everyone is doing, but we've been commanded to return the affair, raddu rasul, we return affair back to the messenger. And here in this case, this means the sunnah of the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he also commands us to return the affair, the public affair of fear of safety, to return it back to ulil amni minhum, to those in authority from amongst them. And this is ahlul ilm, the people of knowledge, wa wulatul umur fi bilad al-islamiyya, the leaders of the Muslim world. This affair must be returned back to them. Because they are the ones that know best what to abstract in that affair and how to deal with that affair. He says that if we were to go and look at the tafsir of Sheikh al-Sa'di in relation to this ayah, Sheikh al-Sa'di, rahimahullah, he says in relation to this verse, this is a disciplining from Allah to His slaves upon them doing that which is not suitable for them to do. That which is not suitable for them, that when it comes to them, the thing that is not suitable for them, is that when it comes to them an affair or public affairs that are important, that is going to be the general benefit for all of mankind, or all of the people, that which is connected to safety and pleasing the believers, or is connected to fear, in which in it is an affliction upon them, is that they must be investigate the affair and not be hasty with spreading any news in relation to that affair. Rather, they must return it back to the messenger. They must return the affair, and it's Sheikh Saadi talking. They must return the affair back to the messenger. They must return the affair to those in authority amongst them, who are Ahlul Ra'i, the people of proper opinion, the people of knowledge, the people of true and sincere advice, the people of sound intellect, the people of wisdom, the people who make the razan of sound decision. Those who know the affairs, those who know what is beneficial and what is opposite of it. For in ra'au fi idha'atihi masa'il, that if they see that in spreading that affair there is some rectification, then wa nishatan lil, and it will be bring vigor to the believers and pleasure to them and protection from their enemies, then they will do so and spread it. But if they see that it is not in that affair rectification or benefit, any benefit in it, there is no benefit in it, or there is benefit in it, but the benefit that is in it, the harm will increase if they bring that benefit about in spreading that affair, then they won't spread that affair. But this is for them to do that. For this reason, Allah Ta'ala says, لَعَلِمَهُ الَّذِينَ يَسْتَنْبِتُونَهُ مِنْهُمْ, that those, they know best what to abstract in that affair, those from amongst them. Sa'adi says, meaning, they will abstract from that with their intelligence and their opinions that is firm and correct and on what's right, and based on and their knowledge, their guided knowledge that they have. If he had them, they will determine the proper thing to do with using those means that they have. And for this reason, this is a proof of the qa'idatul adabiyya, of the well-known disciplinarian rule, which is إِذَا حَصَلَ بَحْثٌ فِي أَمْرٍ, that there occurs research in an affair from the affairs, it is a must, and you what do walla man huwa ahlun lidhalika, that you must be turned to those who are qualified to deal with that affair, and that affair must be returned back to those people, and no one must proceed before them anything else. فَإِنَّهُ أَقْرَبُ إِلَى الصَّوَابِ, because this is the closest thing to what is correct, and it is the more deserving of things that will bring security and soundness from mistake. For in this is the prohibition of being hasty, of rushing out there to spread affairs on the strength of just hearing it. For the command here is to ponder before speaking, to reflect. For this, for hal huwa maslah, is this something that's good? And so Sheikh Saadi, he brought this. And so the Sheikh, he went on to say, after quoting Sheikh Saadi, he says, we find today, unfortunately, you have many of the people who will go on social media like WhatsApp, and they'll spread all types of stuff and cause all types of problems. Rather, they may cause people to fall into innovation, misguidance, because of what they may spread, and get people to do the wrong thing in these affairs. He says, this is why the affairs must be returned back. And the Sheikh says, we're continuing our next portion now.
فأيها الإخوة, مسائل الفتوى مسائل عظيمة جدا, ويجب الحذر من الكلام بغير علم. وهناك من الناصحين والصالحين من ضاق صدره لما منع من الزيارة والعمرة أو من المساجد وصلاة الجمعة, وهذا قرارات تصدر من الدولة, والدولة الإسلامية المملكة العربية السعودية حرسها الله, ليس من طبعها ولا من عادتها ولا من أخلاقها, لا قادة ولا مسؤولين ولا علماء, أنهم يريدون الإضرار بالمسلمين أو التضييق على الدعوة, وهذا شيء معروف عند الجميع. فهم هذه الدولة عرفت ولله الحمد بخدمة الإسلام والمسلمين وتيسير أمورهم وتمريرهم, لكن لما اتضح لدى المختصين في وزارة الصحة, والآن الأخبار بين أيديكم, هؤلاء الذين يموتون في إيطاليا وقد مات خلق كثير فيها, ويموتون في إيران, ويموتون في الصين ويموتون في دول أخرى أعداد غفيرة، وقد ثبت لدى الأطباء أن هذا ينتقل بسبب المصافحة. فلو سألنا سائلا وقلنا له هل ترضى أن تموت أنت من ضمن الذين ماتوا؟ هل ترضى أن تموت أنت؟ ربما بعض الناس يطرق الكلام على عواهنه ولا يهتم، يقول أي نعم نعم، لكن لو نزل به المرض لأصابه الخوف ولصار يرتعد ولصار يقول كيف هذا، أريد العلاج عالجوني. إذن يا أخي الكريم، الوقاية خير من العلاج. الدولة تريد الوقاية للمسلمين، وهذه الدول غير الإسلامية فعلتها. أين العقل؟ أين العقل؟ لو قيل لعاقل نحن إذا أخذنا بالأسباب ومنعنا الناس من التلاقي خفت المصيبة وخف المرض، وإذا عكسنا الأمر وسمحنا بالتلاقي بين الناس يحدث أن تنتقل العدوى بينهم، فبدل ما يكون المريض واحد يكون المريض 100 200 300، وواحد ينقل للألف العدوى. وهذا سمعناه في الحديث أول ما بدأنا بالحديث. أين العقل يعني؟ هل العقل قل لا نبالي؟ لا، نأخذ بالأسباب. فالله أيها الإخوة الكرام، عليكم بالتخلق بهذين الخلقين اللذين حث عليهما الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم، الحلم والأناه. كما عرفنا فضل هذين الخلقين عرفنا ذم ضدهما. فضد العقل والحلم ضده الطيش والتهور، وضد الأناة التعجل وترك الرفق. فنسأل الله أن يهدينا وسائر إخواننا المسلمين للتخلق بما وجهنا به الرسول الكريم صلى الله عليه وسلم. والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
عليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته. الله أكبر، الله أكبر، الله أكبر. The Sheikh Hafidhullah, he continued on. He said, let's talk about how the religion has praised some of the companions and how the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has praised some of the Sahaba, some of the companions of the Messenger of Allah. And he began to narrate a hadith that's in Sahih Bukhari, that the Messenger of Allah had told Al-Ashajju Abdul Qais radiallahu ta'ala anhu, who had came with a group from amongst his people to accept Islam and give pledge of allegiance to the Messenger of Allah. He was among them. And when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam met this man and saw his ways, he said, إن فيك خصلتان يحبهما الله ورسوله. Verily, you have two characteristics that Allah and His Messenger loves the both of them. الحلم والأناة. Forbearance and deliberation. Forbearance and deliberation. And so he began to say, Abdullah Ashajji Abdul Qais, he began to say, this is my natural qualities that I have. I'm naturally like this. The Prophet said, no, but it is Allah who granted you those qualities. And then he said, because he was a person of Iman, he said, Alhamdulillah, الذي جبل جبلني على حلمي والأنا. He says, may Allah, all praises due to Allah, the one who created me with these qualities of hilm and ana, of forbearance and deliberation. And so the Shaykh Hafidhullah, after quoting this hadith, he says, عَلَيْنَا بِالتَّخَلُقِ بِهَذَيْنِ الْخَصْلَتَيْنِ. He said, or هَتَيْنِ الْخَصْلَتَيْنِ. The Shaykh said, it is upon us to assume the qualities and characteristics of these two characteristics. الحلم forbearance, والأناة, and deliberation. So therefore, the thing is to talk about after that is what is the definition in a religion? What is the definition of حل and الأناة? What is the definition? He says, الحلم, forbearance, is عقل, is having intelligence. عقول السليمة شديدة راجحة. It is having a strong, preponderating intelligence that come around, that makes the proper decisions. Wisdom. He says, الأناة, deliberation, it means الترسل وعدم التعجل. He says it is to be deliberate, to be slow, to reflect, to ponder, not to be, to lack being hasty and rushing into things, but to ponder over them properly and take your time so that one arrives at the proper decision. He says these two qualities is the characteristics that we must strive for, because when you look at حلم, this opposite of it is having stupidness, having not the proper mindset. And he says, whereas also whereas forbearance is a person who has a preponderating intelligence. He makes the best decisions and the proper decisions in affairs that will bring about the best results. And then he went on to say, when we look at anatu, deliberation, that is the opposite of it is hastiness. And because hastiness leads to many mistakes and errors, regret for one's actions. So it's important to assume these qualities and characteristics. And the Shaykh Hafidhullah, he went on to say that this deliberation is, or this hadith is illustrated in the statement of the Messenger of Allah. He says, where la yakunu rifqu fi shay'in illa zana, that gentleness do not exist in anything except that it beautifies it. وَلَا يُنْزَعُ مِنْ شَيْءٍ إِلَّا شَانَ, and it's not removed from an affair except that it mars the beauty of that affair. It makes it ugly, look repugnant. For this is what is the result of the characteristic of having حِلْم and أَنَا, having forbearance and having the characteristic of deliberation. Slowing things down, pondering over affairs, trying to arrive at the best decision that will bring about the best results. This characteristic is a must, that it must be seized and assumed by the believer, that they must have this intellect. And this is rasikhuna fil ilm, those who are deeply endowed with knowledge. And so we should realize that when we look at, the Shaykh goes on to talk about, when we look at these affairs and the decisions that the scholars and the rulers of the Muslims have made in regard, the ruler of the Muslims in our kingdom has made, and the world at large has made, his wisdom in it. And it's connected to this. This stuff was pondered over and reflected over. He said it wasn't just no hasty move, but they realized that when people would come into gatherings and to be in groups, that it did nothing but exacerbate the disease and cause the rapid spread of it. And that this is important for us to adhere to these commands and orders, because these are the ones we're supposed to refer to affairs. And then the Shaykh, he said, this is why it is incumbent for us to do is to protect ourselves. This not praying in the jama'at and not praying in the jum'ah, that all of this is established for our protection. That's based off of hilm and ana, from the inheritors of, or from the those who have deeply endowed the knowledge. And then the Shaykh, he began to make dua in closing, and he said, may Allah guide us to this tremendous characteristic and guide us to what's good, and he make more dua of khayr, of goodness for the Muslims and the ummah, and he made dua of protection from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he ended with saying, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.